void. The void. But the void is an important thing. In the void, everything is. So it's not only the object, but it is the interconnection of the different objects in such a way that you can talk about something active is going on in this composition. And we don't need anything more. We can, of course, bring more things. And we say, well, let's make it more complicated. Let's put a tin like that if he wants to stay. You see, part of the bottle will disappear, but something comes back in front. We could bring another box in, an open box together. Our composition gets more complicated. What you also have to look at is the width of every object towards each other. You have a thick belly of the teapot, you have a very thin, elegant bottle, and then you have an in-between tin, and then you have this lovely, I almost sound like Bob Ross, you have a lovely orange, and you have this steady box. So you can make your composition more complicated. You can build it out to all kinds of things so that you can say, now something is going to happen in such a way that when I make a painting of it, you get this special expression of a composition of apart all the objects and at the same time, a new kind of body, which is your still life. So it is the way you put things together which makes it interesting or not. If you put it one beside the other, that's boring. If you take only the same objects, that's boring. So you have to look to the different objects, the height of the objects, the width of the objects. And if you talk about perspective, which we will not do today because that we need a whole workshop for that alone, but it's the depth of the composition. The tin is in front of the bottle and the bottle is in front of the box. That is the deep, the depth composition, you can say. Well, then you have the objects, which is as ensemble, it is looking, no, I think, quite okay, nice. But there is something which is not really, doesn't come out in an expression which is strong. For that, we need light. There is light, but it's a bit diffuse. Light is everywhere. It's coming a little bit from the window over there. You see some gleaming parts, some metal and glass with highlights, but it's still a bit blurred. Then we put on a lamp. I will put on my lamp. What is happening here? You see intensing situation of light and shade by looking at the shades of the object, but also the strong casting shades from the objects on the table. And you see here a beautiful casting shade on the wall. That all belongs to the still life as a whole. You can use these shades to create a space. If you put it off again, you see the difference. And when you put it on, you see the strong casting shades, and that gives the idea of depth. So these are the important items you have to look at if you put something there to make a drawing of a painting of. So we have the shape, the construction of the shape, we have the composition, putting things together to let it become one whole, and then we have the lighting, which creates more intensification in light dark. You can say clair obscur, that's a professional term for that. It is light-dark situation, which creates space. So these are the things you have to start doing when you put your objects together. From that point on, we will start drawing it. And that is what I showed you with these construction drawings. We will do that to start with only in contour. That means that you only will do the outlines of the shapes in this composition and try to construct it well. So what you are now going to do is create your table, take your objects. It doesn't have to be so many. You can take just three or four, whatever. And then you will put your light on in such a way that you get these beautiful shades on the background and on the box. And you get the highlights on the gleaming, the metal and the glass objects. So this is still now my theory about it. We will continue later about how to continue with the drawing. But first I would like you to put down your still life. And if that is ready and your idea, just send me the photo via the app. I can comment on that.
Martin, yes? While everyone does that, it's just one, I forgot to start recording it in the beginning. I started it a bit later. And I want you to, if you can show the, you know, the drawing and how you were building the composition of the bottle. And the teapot.
The construction, you mean? The construction drawing?
The construction drawing. If you could just show it and just like just give a very quick like 2 to 4 minute brief of that.
Yeah, one moment. I will take it in front of the... Can you see it clearly?
Yes, yes.
So again, the middle axis... Then the sides, now I drew over it to get the round shapes, but it's about the geometrical shapes you have to start, but that you can remember from the explanation.
Yeah. Okay, I think that's good enough. Yeah.
Okay. From Mo, I get now a composition to put that already down, I see. Well, that looks quite wonderful. This is what you can call a real composition. Very nice object, Mo. Be careful for the background. Don't make it too complicated. That you can focus more on the composition of your objects. So the window and the curtains, try to make it just as a background as I have here. Otherwise the focus will be too much on the background and you should have it on your still life. Okay, then I go to Zinat. Zinat, the composition is a little bit towards each other. It's too compact actually to give the shapes the right expression. So I should advise you just to put a little bit, like say the red pot a little bit more to the left so that you get a little bit more space in between the middle object, which is I think a lid from that pot, and then the pot to the side so that there is some more in between. Your background is excellent and the subjects of the objects are okay, no problem. It's all round. That if you have a square or a box or a cube-like object, that would be nice if you can combine that with your round objects, with your pots. So,
Martin, I have one doubt.
Should
we do the bottle and the teapot first, or should we do the one behind your the background, the screen, the bottle, the box, the orange, the everything? Which one to do?
You have to bring them together.
Which one? Which to bring together?
No, the different objects you chose. You, if you have a teapot and a bottle and a box, you just bring them together on the table in such a way. And you can also look to the app examples of other people. You see by Sushi that she also has a very clear, nice composition.
Okay.
So that gives you a clue how to use your objects.
Yeah.
So Sushi, that's very nice. You have different kind of objects. That's.
We have to bring the objects together, is it? We have.
Yeah. You have to bring them together. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You're not going to draw from my still life, but you have to make your own still life. Yes.
Sure. Thank you. I'll get it.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay, Sushi, you can. You have a nice. The light is already there, so that's beautiful. This black bottle is very nice to construct from out of the middle axis, that you get this right at both sides, the symmetrical part of it. And also that you put the tin on top of the box, that gives also a kind of a triangle-like composition. And that's always a strong composition. A triangle composition has certain tension, as we call it. Mo Azinat, now you put the pot a little bit aside. I should not put the drawing, the color pencil box there. That gives a little bit more, makes it more complicated. So I should take that away. Only the, if you have a real cube-like box, it would be better. If you understand what I mean. Let's even kijken. Asherby, also that is a good composition. Excellent, almost the same objects as I have, the box, the orange, the bottle, and then you have the tin, and then you have some milk pan. Excellent, with the handle to one side, you can see it gets this way. You can say the compactness of the composition is okay, because you have these vertical differences, the height of the bottle, and then a bit lower the orange, and then you get a direction of the handle of the milk pen to one side, and that makes the composition very exciting. Very good. Then we go Hamna. Also good, creative in the sense that you put all these different things together, and also that you use very clearly the counter shape in between the objects. So that goes very well.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. No, I think I have everything. Only Zinat, can you find a box, something like a cube-like box?
Yeah, I'm trying.
Yeah, just try, just find.
Martin, I had a question.
Yes, you can ask.
Are these done freehand, or is it okay to use a scale for the initial shapes?
Well, I would like you to do freehand in that way, because it's important that you make a more artistic drawing of it, not too much like with ruler and these kind of things. Okay. Try to get a straight hand too, that you can make, let's say, a vertical line out of freehand drawing.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay, I think I have all of you now compositions. So
I think we have Govind is missing. Govind, are you still working on your still life setup?
Yeah, Govind. Yeah. Have a look.
Okay, we have it now.
Yeah. This is only three objects, but you can say with three, it is all right. the different heights of the objects is good. The only thing which is still not there is a rectangle or a cube-like thing, like a box. If there is something you can find long, oblong kind of rectangular shape, that would be nice. Otherwise, it's all round, you see.
Is it for me?
Yeah, it's for you.
Okay, so the you want me to put another rectangular
box? Shape, like, yeah, like a box.
Like a box, and then put the orange on that, yeah?
Yeah, just have a look if you can put it behind the bottle, for instance.
Yeah.
You have to look how that will be the best way to put it more to the left or more to the right.
Sure. So the box should be behind the bottle.
You can try, yes, because if you put it in front, then the your orange will disappear.
Sure.
Yep.
So I'll try that. Thank you.
Okay. Very good. Good. And Prerna.
Oh, I'm sorry. I would love to do that too.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, but no, you don't have anything. To. You have to keep everything in order. So, right. Oh, yeah. And always for everybody to start with, of course, you can make all kind of pictures with backgrounds, interior backgrounds or whatever. But for now, I should advise you just to take a simple background like I showed you. Towards the wall or whatever, because then also your casting shade can be partly on the wall, which gives you the possibility to make space like you see in my composition here. Take your time for it. I mean, the artist I showed you, this Giorgio Morandi, he was taking days to make a good composition. He had all the time the same kind of objects, and his whole life he worked with that. But he took really a very long time to put a composition on the table. Now, you don't have to do that now, because then you won't get to drawing, but take your time to get a really good composition. Always when you put a still life up, that you say, okay, now I have an idea and this is something I like to work on. Oh yes, Govindrai, that's much better.
How's this, Martin?
Yeah, that's fine, Govindra. That is very nice. Now you put it right together.
Yeah.
And there is this. The only thing is that the background, if you can manage to have a wall behind it, I don't know if that is possible.
I have a board.
Okay, super.
Yeah. So I'll put a board, and then I have to start drawing now.
Yes, then you can start trying for everybody who, what I said. Also, Zinat. Yeah, that's much better thing.
Yes.
Yeah, thank super.
You. So I need to put the board behind it and start drawing on the drawing.
Yes, that you get a real more quiet background, and that gives you the possibility if you put a light in such a way that you get a casting shade near the wall.
Yeah, but the thing is, when I draw when you explained the bottle to pick a mutter rectangular and then triangle, I will do the same thing to construct a bottle. But then to make a rectangle, you need a scale, isn't it?
Yeah, you need a scale in such a way. If you think more happy with that, then it's all right. I mean, it's only that it will get correct, that you get a symmetrical shape, which is a bottle is a symmetrical shape.
Okay, that the spacing should come equal everywhere.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, Prerna, that is your example, I see.
Yes.
Yeah, well, you have some experience already, so you had it immediately all right. Well, you have the casting shades. Do you have a lamp on it, or is it from daylight?
I actually just turned on the lamp, and I'm just trying to put some shadow, some casting shadow here, like...
Okay,
yeah, I'm just giving it a try. I know I didn't have any, I didn't prepare for anything. I could have done better.
No. That is wonderful. That's what you see nice because when you start a drawing or a painting, you have, of course, your sheet of paper or your canvas, which has a certain size. If you have a composition which is more horizontal, so one next to the other, then you have to put your canvas or your paper in the lying position. You have the standing position, that's upwards, and you have the lying. In this composition I put on the table, I should say the paper should be in a lying position, yeah, because it's more horizontal.
Okay.
And then it's of course the size of the canvas which you put around, and you have to think how big will your composition will be on the paper or on the canvas. And this time with this, of course, the paper. So think about the background, think about the counter shape. So don't draw it too small with a lot of white of your paper, but also not too big that that it will burst out of your paper. Try to get a balance between the size of the paper, and that is the background, and your composition. And for that, of course, you can use your camera, your telephone, you can zoom in or out, that you say, well, this is a good combination, background and composition. Try to draw lightly in the beginning with your charcoal. So don't push too hard because it becomes very thick and black and it's difficult to erase. So if you start drawing very lightly, I always use my charcoal at the end of the stick. I have a very thin one, as you can see. And then I just go over it without pressure, so that I get very light lines, and then I can easily put a better line, correction there, and I can use an eraser or a brush to take away the old line. So keep it very lightly. If you get a little bit nervous by this completely white sheet and that you ask yourself, where shall I begin? You know that you have to make a still life, but how you will start is always difficult. I will show you a little bit in a quick shorthand manner how you could do that. So you look actually to the middle of your whole composition. You can make this vertical axis for the composition. And then you say, okay, the height and the lower part. Then you make interconnected lines to get it in such a way that you first think about the composition as one thing. One thing. So you see, I made actually the circumcise of the whole composition, if you can see that. We'll make it slightly stronger so that you can see what I'm doing. So it's kind of, you can say, a, From there, you can start to make very simple the sketches of your different objects. The box here, and then you get the orange on top. Go down. Here you see, I do it with a very sketchy, in a very sketchy manner. The teapot should be lower here. Make it first as a kind of complete triangle. Then I have here the tin, which is a slightly ellipse. I will bring that there. I get the bottle. From my viewpoint, it is just coming to the backside of the box. I make this construction very simple. Then I go and construct it. The other box, what I have here, is slightly in an angle. So I'm not fixing anything yet. I only try to bring the objects in such a way together that the composition will be in the right manner together. And then after that, when I think, okay, this is all right, I have here my eraser. I hope you can see it, what I'm doing. I can take some lines away, which should not be there. It's only to start with. And then, for instance, you start with the biggest object. You're going to bring the box. You construct it better than with the sketch. From there, you get make the teapot. And what I said with the construction, as I showed you, keep on looking to your objects. Never take your eyes from it, because the moment you start to invent, it will be wrong. So always keep yourself focused on the objects. And if you think, hey, that's not right, then you start, you erase it, and you start all over again. But keep this shorthand going. That's important. So don't start to do this with one line. You have to make it very loose to find the right shape and volume of the things. And then slowly, by this construction, you get more and more the right shapes. you are actually growing into your drawing. And every time you look to your still life, and every time you ask yourself, is this the right shape, but also is it the right counter shape? Or shall I correct it? It's never good in one go. As long as you keep that in mind, it's never good in one go, and you always have to search and find the correct shape. Okay, Prana, this is a nice sect or champagne bottle. A Vrizzano, an Italian Prosecco. Very tasty. Gives you always inspiration. And also, tell me.
I'm saying I don't have a large sheet right now, so I'm just drawing on an A4 sheet.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. Doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be very big. You can also A4, doesn't matter. But then you should use a thinner material like a pencil.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. Yeah. Pencil. Okay. Yeah.
Very good. Look at your casting shape also as if it is an object. So that you will put it in composition together with your object composition, eh? So that you give it the right place on your sheet of paper. And no shading yet, huh? Only contour, only outline. Because the moment you start to shade, then you will get apart from the right construction. And then you have made a very nice drawing, but the shape is not right. And that's very frustrating. So keep yourself focused on the construction of the shapes, the forms, the objects. And that's the nice thing of charcoal, that you can always easily take it away, erase it. So if you find from time to time time to see what I'm doing, you see that I also go over it all the time. I mean, correct it every time, take away, look to the ideal shape. Just as long as when till I think, well, this is what it should be. And then you are ready for the next step. But take your time. Okay, Mo, have a look. Yes. Yep. There are boxes, excellent in perspective. Very nicely conversational to the background, so that goes very well. I don't know what it is. It's blue object, like a water pipe, perhaps. I'm not sure what it is, or a kind of teapot.
It's actually a bong.
What?
It's a bong. Like, it's called a bong.
Okay, good. Yeah, I don't know. It's completely new for me. It is a little bit standing in an angle towards the bottle. So you have to make it more straight upwards. It could be that because the paper is in perspective, that it looks like it, but did you make the vertical axis completely vertical?
Yeah, it's vertical. It just seems in the picture.
Okay, now then I didn't see
anything. I'll click a better picture.
Yeah, that's perhaps, if you can't make it straight from above, then I get the right idea. Mm-hmm. Because I'm going to look to your composition. Yeah, here I have it, yeah. Okay. Okay, then I go to Zenat. Zenat, yeah, your construction manner is going fine. Yeah. Nice, the middle axis there, and then the construction of the shapes, that goes fine. That goes fine. Also the ellipse-like movement, always, although you don't see them everywhere, in the first setup of your outline drawing, always draw the whole ellipse. Also when there is a pot with something in, that you will just get the idea right. So that is, because that is of course a perspective idea, that it will be all standing on one table.
Got it.
Yeah. And make clear for yourself, because you put it somewhere on your sheet of paper, which is the size of your paper. So that you will say, make a line. Well, I go as high as this. The width should be there. And then you make a line and underneath. So that it won't stand forlorn on the sheet of paper, but that it has to do with the size of it. Now I see. I see. I see the drawing of Mo. That's good. So now does this bong, what you say, that is all right. Perhaps the apple should be slightly bigger. Slightly bigger.
Okay.
Otherwise it becomes a cherry.
Yeah.
Okay. Govindra.
Yeah.
Yeah, yours, I see. Yeah, the box is okay on top.
The orange.
Sorry?
The orange on the top of the box.
Yeah, the orange on top of the box, but I go have a look for your... Yeah, the shape of the bottle, you take the belly too big in comparison with the neck of it. So try to construct it because you go a little bit more around in a curved-like manner. Try to give it straight and rectangular for the neck and then a triangle for the... For the shoulders of it and then the belly, so that it will be clear.
Sure, I'll do that. Anything else? Overall, the composition is okay?
The composition is okay. That's as you put it down. That's wonderful.
Okay. Thank you. Only the bottle I need to change the...
Yes, that should be more straight and the right size with the neck and the belly of the bottle.
Yeah, okay. So I need to follow the rectangle. I followed that, but still I don't know how it went off out of a little bit because I was trying to follow the bottle exactly in front of me.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, so, okay. But try to construct, because on the photo when I look to it, that is much more, the belly is less high and the shoulders are very sharp triangularly towards the top of the bottle.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, sure. Thanks. Thanks for the feedback.
Yes, of course.
Martin? I have one question. I'm using the same willow charcoal for drawing and I have this this clay eraser, but I'm not able to like rub it completely. What kind of eraser are you using?
Well, to sketch, I use this. This is a kind of duck wing. That's what they sometimes sell in Holland. But what you can use, I don't know if you have that nearby, but it's a kind of brush, like a thick oil paint brush will also do. And if you don't have that, then you need an eraser, an India rubber. These are actually the only three objects. I always advise these things you can hardly buy. I bought them very long time ago. I usually advise to take a shaving brush. Men have this, you can shave in, that is a good brush, or a cosmetic brush, which you can powder your face, for instance. They are very soft hair, and then you can easily take it away.
And you're using a cartage sheet, right? Ivory paper?
Yeah.
No, the paper on which you're drawing. That's an ivory paper.
Yeah, exactly.
And Martin, I assume this, so this eraser that you're using is basically a bird's...
bird wing.
Bird wing, actually. Yeah. Right? I not remember so you had given one to me.
And, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, as a vegetarian, I would not advise you to buy it. I bought it many, many years ago. They are still good, so I don't just use them. But what I explained, the cosmetic brush or a shaving brush, these are actually the right items to use to quickly erase your charcoal lines.
Yeah, and otherwise, actually, I've been collecting these a lot, like in India on terraces, and all. You get a lot of bird wings, actually, in your garden and places.
Okay. So well,
that could be one way, yeah.
And it's always useful to step back from your drawing from time to time so that you don't put yourself too near at the same distance from your drawing, because from a good distance, you can see better if your composition is right, if your constructions are right. So take a step backward to look at your sketch. Prerna. Oh, yes, good. Because you used the right part for the casting shade, I suppose.
Yes, I think so.
Because you put it all to the left. It's good not to put it immediately to the middle. And that okay. You always try to avoid. Mm-hmm. But for this sketch, I don't mention that too much because we have to try first to get composition right and the objects. But it's always good to think out of middle, but don't put everything from the middle or in the middle.
Okay, I didn't understand that part actually.
Most people, they start to make a drawing in the middle of the paper. Yeah?
Yeah.
And you did rightly to put it more to the left, which is good because, as I suppose, your light is coming from the left side, so you get these casting shades, as you see in my composition, what I mentioned, this long, dark part on the background.
Yes, I have good casting shape too, yeah.
Yeah, well, then you use the casting shade to fill actually also your right side of your drawing so that there is a balance between left and right.
Correct, yeah.
Yeah, I understand?
Yeah, now I get it, yeah.
Okay, super. Yeah, sure. That looks very nice. That looks a very good composition. It's a pity your handle is not yet there. It's getting out of the picture. And that has to do that you, when you observe your composition, you know the height, that is the high bottle, and you observe the width, which is the handle of the milk pen.
Large enough piece of paper.
Yeah, exactly. But most of the time it's better if you can get it all within the size of your paper. But the placing of the objects are very good because you put a bottle more to the left and you get at the right side because of the orange or apple, what is it? And the box, you get a exciting counter space in the background. That's what I meant with the counter space. So you use that in a proper way.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. About the ellipse and perspective, that is, of course, we will mention it. We will not go too deep into detail, but with the box, the round tin down at the left side down is slightly too round. So that you get an idea that you look too much upon the tin and you should more look to the side of the tin.
Okay.
You get it?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Hamna, okay. You put down the composition in the proportional manner. Excellent. I mean, it's what they is, the volume of the bottle opposite to the water cooker and the box and these things. Well done. Good in proportion with each other. It's a pity that the handle of the water bottle just falling out of your paper. Yeah. And try to avoid that next time. Just leave it now, but always try to know, and that's what I mean. You start with a sketchy way of setting up, I mean, so that you know for sure that everything will get into the size of your paper and not at the last moment, I have to get out of the paper. Sometimes that gives an extra tension of your composition, but in this way, it's just out of the paper, and that gives a not pleasant, satisfying look.
Okay, understood.
So, but just leave it as it is. And the only thing what you still can do is the ellipse of the top of your round tin, down. If you compare it, the top is slightly too round in comparison with the bottom of the tin.
Okay.
To try to make it more flat, the ellipse of the lid.
Sure.
Yep, super.
Yeah, like that.
All right, in 5 minutes time, we have a break for 15 minutes. You can just continue if you like, or drink some nice tea or whatever. try to finish your outline drawing in such a manner that you think, okay, that's fine for the moment, because after the break, we will talk about the next step. Yeah, Prayer, I see.
Yeah.
What do you want to show me exactly?
Oh, just that I've finished the shape.
Yeah.
Completed, that's all. And then I'll follow the next step that you teach.
So. Yeah, absolutely, that we will do. Perhaps you can see that the right side of your bottle, the outline there, is slightly different from your left side.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'm trying to work on it. Yeah.
Of the body. Right. The right side is slightly too bulky, too much of a belly.
Okay. All right.
The construction of the rectangular shape towards the neck or the shoulder of the bottle is slightly different if you look from one to the other.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. Sushi. Yeah. Okay. That looks very fine. Yeah, it's good use of shape and counter shape. So the composition is all right for the next step. Well sketched, well drawn. I always advise if you have trouble with looking to if it's symmetrical or not, to use a mirror. So that you put your drawing in front of the mirror and look to it, and you will immediately see where it is right and where it's wrong. So the mirror helps you to see the symmetrical part of your construction.
So Martin, are we breaking for 15 minutes and we catch it after 15 minutes in a way?
Absolutely. I'm going to make a nice coffee for myself. I see you soon.
Yeah, see you.
Perhaps you want to just correct some things in your outline drawing, that's fine. But I will now explain the next step in the drawing. And for that, if it's possible, we need a short piece of charcoal. I have a slightly thicker charcoal. I don't know if you have that, but just have a look. And I have my willow charcoal, which is very thin. We are going to do shading. That's the next part. We have the outline drawing, the construction of the drawing, the composition, placing of the whole composition within the size of the paper. These are the starting points of your still life that you will say, okay, fine, now it's on the right place. The background, the shapes, and the constructions are reasonably good, right? Because it is a process you are in. It doesn't have to become completely perfect in the beginning. It's a process you are in, and outlines, well, you can say an outline doesn't exist in nature. We call it an outline, but we have to say it are borders of an object towards another object. And as we write with lines, we human beings are tend to think in borders, in borderline, in the side of a object. But it's an invention. And it's an easy way of putting very quickly your shape on the paper. But what we actually see, if we have the light on, that's important, and you get these beautiful shades and casting shades, And you look slightly through the eyelashes. So almost closing your eyes as I do at the moment, so that you will only see a bit of a blurred situation in front of you. So that all details will slightly fade away and you see the bigger story, the bigger thing like light and dark. We are going to do shading. And for that, we have to look through the eyelashes. There are different manners to put the shading on the paper. The easy way and the fastest way is take a short piece of charcoal and you use the side of your charcoal. And I start with the box here, because we see the outer part is light, but the inner part is dark. Now, what you can do is to use the side of your, first you have to make it flat, that you use this in a very fast manner. You get this immediately, these big patches of shade, and that's what you want. And you can work very fast. Only have to be careful that you follow the shape of the shade, right? The shape of the shade. That's one way. Another way is hatching. For that you use the small one. And let's say the casting shade of the bottle on the box, you see that going here. I will try to do that in a hatching manner. Don't make the hatching too long. Don't go like this, because then it doesn't work. So you have to do it in a short movement. Like this, and you stop here. You see that is the mouth of the teapot. So you will stop there, because otherwise it disappears and you don't want it. Then you can go slightly in another angle on top of it to make it slightly darker. So that is the hatching manner. And you see it's a blurred kind of shade. So you don't have to be too exact, because that's not what you want. That's the hatching way. What you can also do is use your finger, for instance, or you have special tools for it. Mo did something with the Buddha, what I can remember. That is that you will go, but it's very nice when you use pastel or you use charcoal, you bring your shade there, and then with the top of your finger, you just go over it. And then you get a very smooth patch of shade. And then you can go over it again to make it slightly darker. Yeah, and you can also say after a while, I go hatching over it. It doesn't really matter. But there are these three different ways, methods of bringing shade on your drawing. So what you first will do is bring the darkest, the strongest part of the shading on your paper. And don't forget also the casting shades on the wall. Be careful that you don't go over your other object, because then it disappears and you have to do it all over again. So be careful. And you see, in a very fast manner, you get to these shades. And then you see the dividing of white paper, which is light, and dark patches, which is shade. And in this manner, you are going to divide your still life into what you actually see apart from the color, is light and dark. And as I explained in the beginning, if you do that in the proper way, then it starts to become space-like. You see a depth coming through it, because there is a casting shade, there is a shade, so you suggest a distance between the bottle and the box. That's why the shade of the bottle is here, because there is a distance. Okay, So for you to decide, are you going to hatch or do you use the side of your charcoal? And you can always use an eraser, an India rubber, if you went too far. Okay, you erase it again. It's very easy with charcoal. And then you do it again. Okay, let's start.
Okay, I have a question, Martin.
Yeah, you can always ask.
So basically, hatching has different kind of hatching, like cross hatching, then different style of hatching. Yes. So is it like if I'm doing still life drawing, yeah, is it like okay if I try cross hatching or different kind of hatching? Like,
well, you mean cross hatching,
you know, crisscross, yeah, or
yeah, yes, don't make it, yes, too mechanically.
Like it would give,
yeah, tell me.
Like when I use my anatomy drawing, I try cross hatching more than shading or like normal hatching.
I understand.
So that, yeah, that gives a different kind of perspective and different like effect on the paper or on the body. So is, yeah, it like okay if I try that? Or if it's like on still life objects?
Yes, that is no problem. The only thing is with cross hatching, if you mean to do very straight like this, you have to be careful that it won't become too mechanical. It becomes like, let's say, an iron fence. So the best way is to move your wrist. So you can do, I will show you, you can do this, and then you can also do this. You can go back also this, but try to do it with a sketchy hand, not too much constructing, because then it becomes very wooden, very stiff.
Got it.
You got it. Good. Yes. Try it out. Hamna, very good. You made a new one. Excellent, excellent. Much better.
Okay.
So you can start hatching or use the side of your charcoal or whatever to make the shades.
Sure.
Be careful not immediately too black. More black, the more problematic it is to erase it. So always start lightly. Give yourself the possibility to grow in your drawing, that you get it more and more as you see it. And that's always better to do it first lightly. If it's not correct, you can erase it. And when it's correct, you can make it deeper. As you probably notice while you are shading at the moment, just continue while I talk. With metal objects or glass, it's slightly more complicated because with solid opaque objects like the box, you can easily see a dark part and a light part, shade and light. But with glass and with metal, you see also reflections. You can look through the glass of the bottle and you see a reflection in the metal surface of the teapot. Well, it is a big story, as you can also see in my still life. You can see very clearly a light at this side of the teapot. And what you also see is very light dots and a stripe of light on the bottle. But the shade in the glass is more difficult. And you see only green. In the teapot, it's a little bit better because here you see with a couple of stripes and then a kind of rectangular part, which is dark. But then you see a reflection of the white table underneath. That makes the shape much more difficult. And that has to do, of course, with the material, with the texture of the thing. That means that how to show that something is metal or glass. That has to do with the highlights and the reflections. So what I'm going to do, I will start the teapot, which is my teapot is metal, as you know. And then I will just bring in the big story of the shade. And I do that in a hedge-like manner, because that is actually more my way of drawing. But you don't have to follow that. You can have your own way. Well, as long as it works, that's important. And then you see a slightly a tonal difference at this side. And then it becomes here more dark. So what you can see now is that there is something growing. And that is the metal surface of the teapot. You can see I turn my stick slightly in different angles to make it more lively, to give more expression to my shades. Yeah, so try. With the bottle, it's slightly a different story. Of course, we have etiquette there. So we can use that, take it in the round manner because the bottle is round, eh? It's three-dimensional. So you can use it an outline just to give it the right place. This is white. And then what you have to do is give it a tonal value. We have shade, yeah? Shade belongs also to tone, but you have also a tonal value. That means there is a dark green bottle and a light brown box. These are different gray values, as you know. If you could make a photo of your still life and put your camera on black and white, then you see what I mean, because you get these grays. The color disappears, but the color will be translated in darker gray or lighter gray. And that's what you have to have to observe. The green has a certain tonal value, which is darker than that of the box. And then if you come to the highlights, you have to spare out, you can see that, you have to spare out the highlights. It's important. You also have a kind of label here, so that's, and then we have, it's darker. And then we go down, there's also tonal value. But it is recorded, this session. So if you want to continue, you can later see what I do to understand more how to use it. Because it's difficult to do two things in one go. So I did it with the side of my charcoal. And now for the finer parts, for the difference of dark and light in the tone, I will use my hatching. And I spare out the highlights. You see, by doing that, to make it slightly darker, you get the impression of glass. Because that's with a realistic still life, it's important that you also show the material. You can make it slightly darker just around the highlights to get more effect of light. And now I need my India rubber. I have to look. Oh yeah, here I have it. If you want to now make it more clear, to get rid of a little bit, get rid of your sketch drawing, then you can use your India rubber to, such a nice word, India rubber. It's the rubber coming from India. You can erase it clean, you see? In this manner, you get a front and you get a side. So if you went too far, no problem with charcoal. Use your India rubber. You can go play a little bit with the direction of your hatching manner, so that you can also suggest what is going on in the shades, for instance. And the metal has also, you can say, different tonal values in the light as well as in the shade. And the more nuance you can make, the better it will look like. And again, if you think, oh, I went too far, then use your India rubber and continue. Keep on working on your right shape, because by the hatching to bring in the shades, yeah, sometimes your correct drawing will slightly disappear, and then you have to look at it again so that you will have it as you meant to be. You can see slowly that it's getting to a metal situation here. Of course, I do it shorthand very quickly just to show you. And when I had to do it for myself completely to make my own still life, of course, I will do it more carefully. And for such a drawing, if I made, I mostly work about 2 hours for such a composition to get it completely in the right values and correct shape. I mostly start with a drawing for everything, also for painting. And with portraits, I also start first to make a drawing. I do that in a grisaille technique. Perhaps next time we can also look at that method to get stronger light and shape before I start painting, so that I know that I have all the things right, the likeness, the proportions. With drawing, it is much more easy to look at that kind of problematic things than when you immediately start painting. But that depends on what you want. If you want, you can send me a photo of how it's going. If you are uncertain about it. I love this catchy sound, this scratching of the charcoal on the paper. Slightly as if you go with your nails over a blackboard, which you know, very unpleasant, but and if you became too dark and you want to know how to get it slightly lighter, you should not use an India rubber and also not a brush, because it will be completely faded. But what you can easily do, be careful that you will keep your nose closed, that is blowing. If you blow nearby, it will just make it lighter. Okay, Mo, I have it in front of me. That's going fine, Mo. That's going fine. Yes, the casting shade on the box, also from the apple, looks very good. Be aware, also with the bottle, the reese, what I read there, Where is the light on the bottle? Where is the shady parts on the bottle? So look very carefully through the eyelashes. And you see that also with the tin, although there should be shade, you keep it white. You should not do that. Okay, it looks like it, perhaps because it's a metal box or a plastic box, but make it dark so that the top of the tin will be lighter than the sides of the side of the tin. Yeah? Otherwise, you get confused. Where is the light coming from? And you should make it always clear. In your case, it comes from the right. So all left parts of the shapes of the objects are shade. And also make for everybody, make a difference between the object, the clear object, and the decoration, like the name of a certain drink or of the tin. That is a secondary. Primary is that you get the shape right, and that means a three-dimensional suggestion of a bottle. And when that's right, okay, then you can bring in some decoration or lettering, whatever you like, to make it more realistic. But first, light shade, good proportion, three-dimensional, and this idea of space. Hamna, have a look. Okay, that's going fine. That comes already strong and also in tonal values. That's good. Be careful for the construction of your water kettle, that it will be, think about a triangle of the top to the bottom, so that it won't become out of focus. You see that the right part is more round and the left part is more straight. And then you get a not a symmetrical shape.
Okay.
And that you can easily, if you have the line too straight, you erase it and then you follow more mirror-like the other part, you see?
Okay, I'll try that.
Yeah. Have a good look to your bottle on the box. If the ellipse connects with the depth of your box. Now it looks like as if the box is too much upwards and the bottle is standing, is more, yeah, what is it? Not really standing, but floating in the air.
Okay.
Yeah, have a good look.
Yeah, the borders, right, understood.
Good.
Yeah,
Govindra, I'm looking at it. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Here in light and shade.
How's the shading?
Yeah, the shading is going fine. That is good. The way of the side of your charcoal. Be aware in the bottle, and you can easily erase that with your India rubber. Are highlights. You have to spare them out.
Yeah.
So that you will show that. That it's highlight and that it suggests glass.
Yeah.
Like in my drawing. Can you see that?
Sure. So you need to show the highlight of the glass in the bottle.
Yes, you can easily do that by using your India rubber just to get out these highlights and make it white again.
With the rubber, with the eraser, yeah?
With the eraser, yeah. And don't forget the casting shades from the bottle towards the right side, also from the... Yeah, that you give it space.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes. You can also use your fingers from time to time. If the hatching becomes too strong or you want to have it more blurred, just use your finger. That is a very good way of drawing. And as I told you, you can completely smooth it down with your finger or with your tool. The question is only, it can become a little bit too smooth. That you have to be careful. It's more if you hatch, for instance, your drawing is more lively. And the expression of your hatching gives life to your drawing. So a bit of hatching you should show in every part of your drawing.
Hello, Martin and Prerna. Yeah, I have to leave now because I have a train to catch up tonight, but now it's raining also. So I think I have to leave early.
Okay, well, you're, it's all right, no problem. But you have the big story you have, how to build up a drawing, a sketch, and then shading
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I got the basics, yeah. That's exactly. Yeah.
Now, that was the whole idea of this workshop. So that's fine. See you perhaps next time.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Thank you so much, Prerna. Hope that recording helped me for further queries.
Thank you for the lesson.
Yeah. Thank you, then, Alina.
Bye bye. Nice
having you, Amna. Bye.
Yeah, bye.
I wanted to say another thing of hatching is that you can give a certain direction to the way you hatch. Let's say in this part, that is, if you can look to my drawing at the moment, the light is coming in an angle over the still life. It's like that. If you look carefully to the shade on the box, you see that it has this movement slightly in an angle. If you use that, you can also show the direction of the light, which gives much more space. So you can use your hatching in such a way. Also, if you want to have it more round, you can hatch it in a round manner so that in the direction, you can also show the three dimensionality of your object. A great master of that, what I just explained to you, was Albrecht Dürer, the German Renaissance painter. He made also a lot of engravings, as you probably know. Otherwise, you can Google it. And that is an extreme engraving, is an extreme manner to, in the lines, because you use lines, kind of hedge-like lines. And in that way, you can show the three-dimensionality of the shape just by following that very clearly in the roundness of the object. All right, have a look. Zinat, that's going fine. You have a nice way of hatching. You can see that you have quite some rough paper. And it's with lines, as I see, it's very nice paper you have. And then you see that by the structure of the paper, you get more mm-hmm. white in between. Yeah, that's very beautiful. You can use that. Yeah, you can use it so that it doesn't.
I tried cross hatching.
Yes, you did cross hatching, but not too much. So that is all right. But by the paper, it keeps transparent. It keeps open, which is good. The only thing is what you have to try now is to get rid of your preliminary lines, what you started with, like, for instance, the axis, vertical axes in your drawing. And okay. also try to get rid of your outlines more. So that you will hatch in such a manner that your outline in the shade part will almost disappear.
Got it.
Otherwise, you have this very strong outline drawing and then it keeps it flat and you want to suggest this three-dimensional thing.
Got it.
You get it?
Thank you.
Great. Welcome. Have a look, Sushi, to your drawing. Make it bigger. Yeah. Well, it's going fine. Your construction is very good, I must say. Very straightforward, very clear in the whole idea of the object. It's a good unity in the composition. Be careful that you won't go immediately into detail, because it is challenging you. And you see these highlights and also the labels on the different objects, and you want to all use it immediately. Don't do that. Try to avoid that. Try to look through the eyelashes and only look to the bigger part of the light shade and try not to go into the detail yet. Okay. It is something which is, I always say, the detail is like a dessert in a good menu. You start with the soup or the pakori, and then you take your main dish, and after that you have your delicious ice cream or whatever. Those are the nice things, but don't start with the dessert, because then your stomach gets upside down.
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
Martin?
Yes.
Do you think I'm also going too much into detail if you look at my image?
Did you send it?
Yeah, just before.
Oh yeah, I see it. Yeah, you were just in the middle. Okay, it doesn't want to become big. You have it in front. Oh, that's good. Yeah, then I can see it clearly. Yes. Okay, well, your shading can be stronger because you see that the outlines are still very visible, and the point of shading is and tonal values is that you get rid of your contour of your outlines. Of course, they can be partly there. You can also see that in my drawing that I partly have it there. But the point is that what I told you in the beginning, that outlines, they don't exist. That's just an agreement, an appointment we had with how to draw. That we say, okay, we make it first in line and then the rest. So try to make it less visible and to give more depth to your shading. The shapes are all right, no problem. Composition is good, but now you have to get rid of your outlines.
And I think also the problem is my pencil.
Yeah, you have a very light pencil, very hard. Yeah, yeah. Then that's always, you don't have something else, a softer one? Or for...
Not right now, yeah.
Okay, well, just keep on hatching. You can continue a little bit more, but try not to emphasize the outlines too much. Just let it disappear slightly in the shade.
Yeah, I'm just using my fingers actually to...
Okay, that you can also use. Yeah, there, that God gave you fingers.
Yeah, thankfully. We are getting slowly to the last phase of our session. That means that we did step by step the setting up of a drawing. And if the big story of light and shade is there in the hatching manner or whatever you want to use, then to finish, to bring actually the finishing touch to your drawing is to go more into the detail. That can be what I said, the decoration of things or lettering, that you will use it in such a manner that it also will be part of your light shade story. But it can also be like the reflections in the teapot, as you see what I'm doing, that I see a lot of reflections of it, of the table and my easel, that you go more into that. So that the mirror-like thing in the metal will be more clear. So you get more into detail, more to realistic parts to suggest what kind of material you have drawn. And for instance, here you see in my tin, you see, you don't have to do all the things there. I mean, you take still the main part. Otherwise, yeah, you can continue with it, but it takes you more and more time to finish it. But take the most important part, let's say this illustration of the triangles from dark and light, what I have in my tin. It gives also more liveliness to your drawing, more realism. And you show what kind of object it is. And what I told you, the glass also, the darker parts, the lighter parts, the labels, well, the boxes, you can do also that. It's not necessary with every object. You can also just use it for a couple of objects in the foreground.
Have a look, Mo, what you have done now. Oh yeah, now it's getting more subtle. Your tonal values are okay. Also the shade part, you show much more where the light comes from. So that's wonderful. Still your etiquette on the bottle, as what I just was telling about the details, you see you keep it completely white. And also the label, what is on the side of the bottle, with the lettering, is part of your story of light and shade. So look through the eyelashes and see how dark and where, at what a part of it is darker than the other, to get more the realism, to get more the three-dimensionality, also in the etiquette. Still your tin, or what is it, bottle on its side, can be more in a tonal gray. It's still very light in comparison with the lid of it. So try to give it slightly more tonal value, or slightly darker. But it's a nice hatching you are doing. It's going fine. So slowly we go to the detailed parts. As I call it, the dessert of your dinner. Because your sweet rice will always taste better after your Thali main dish. And not before. But be careful not to overdo it, the details, because then your big story of light and shade will disappear. It is secondary. You should look at your eraser as a drawing tool. It's not only to get rid of certain mistakes, but you can also use it as if you are drawing with it. Like, let's say I highlight what I do on the teapot, that I just use it as if I have a tool, a drawing tool in my hand. Especially with charcoal, that works very nicely. But for that, you actually need this kind of India rubber, as you see. That is a kind, you buy it as a flat square thing, but you have to knead it like clay. You have to make a little ball of it. It's a very handy tool. Okay. Ooh, Usher, very nice. Very nicely drawn. Excellent. Nice hatching, good shapes, tonal values, excellent. Also the casting shade, it's a beautiful drawing. You if you have to, still
is
time you...
I can improve on?
Sorry? If
is
okay.
Any place I can improve on?
I don't understand this last what you said. I didn't hear it.
Is there any part of the drawing I can improve on?
Yeah. Oh, that's what you mean. Well, still work on your ellipse. That's that it won't become a pancake, but that it will become a real circle-like suggestion. And perhaps also the etiquette of the bottle. It doesn't go rightly in the roundness of the bottle itself. You see, it's a bit flat in the upper part of the etiquette. So give it also the ellipse suggestion. And then you can bring in some details. If there are some lettering or whatever, you can draw it in if you like. These are small improvements you can make, but it's going really fine.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, you're welcome. And slowly get rid of your outlines where you can't use them. If you look through the eyelashes, sometimes you see almost no difference between the object and the background. And then you should try to bring your outline there back towards the what you really see so that it's not too strong. And use your India rubber for that. The less outline you suggest, the more space you get back. What is also an important part when you're getting to the finishing touch is that you emphasize by stronger hatching, by some deeper accents in your drawing, the front part of your composition. If you want to suggest that it has a depth, your drawing or your painting, that you can look into it, you can say, then the trick to use is to emphasize the front parts of your composition slightly more than the back part. So it, you can say it's a kind of landscape-like using, as you know, with a landscape, especially when it's a bit hazy, then you see the objects in front of you quite sharp, but the hills at the back are fading away, gets lighter, gets more blurred. Well, that you can do also in still life. So by putting the accents in the front slightly stronger, you get a better depth. Okay, dears, it's about time to have a final say. If you want to send me your drawing still now, I can give you a final comment on that. You can, of course, if you have time, continue with your drawing later on. Okay. Mo, good. Yeah, I see you change your bottle to bring it more in the light shade variation. That is a good idea. You can bring in later again with your eraser, you can bring in slightly the text because it can be there. It's only that it will be part of your bigger story about light and shade. That is going fine. Also be careful not to put a light line behind the bottle on the box, because that's not what is happening. If you do that, you actually make a kind of dike. We Dutch are very good in that, you know, make dikes along the rivers and the sea. You should not do that. You should give it a tone, because if you look through the eyelashes, there is not really a light line. It can have the idea that there is something lighter, but that has to do with the optical thing in your eye, that you perceive it as slightly lighter. You can use it, but not too light, otherwise it becomes too flat. Still, your laying bottle on the table in front, underneath, is still too light at the side. Try to make it slightly darker so that the lid will be a really more light and the rest less. Now, and all the other parts are going well. You put it good in front. Perhaps you can make the apples, you can make it slightly lighter by blowing. If you do, if you use charcoal, you can go near to it and then blow. And then you will see that the upper part will be blown away, and then you get a lighter suggestion. Eh? But I said more landscape-like. But it's a good drawing. You made a good hatching, and in the end, also more plasticity, which is important. Okay, and now I go to.
Thank you, Martin.
Yes, you're welcome. Oh, you're welcome.
Martin, go on, Rajiv.
Yeah. I see it in front of me. Now you brought in more highlights. That's excellent. In that way, you get a better idea about the material. You can go slightly deeper. I don't know what kind of material do you use.
I used charcoal and pencil and rubber. Whatever you suggested, I used that.
Yeah. Okay. Well, perhaps with charcoal you can go slightly deeper still.
Okay. Sure.
While you continue, so that there is a more tonal difference between the cup, the box, and the bottle. So you can try some parts slightly deeper, and also get rid of the outlines of the bottle, so that it will be not too strong. Also the cup, eh? That it will disappear in the shade, especially at the shady part of it.
So I should make the shade in the bottle more darker. That's what you're saying with the charcoal.
Yeah. And the cup. Yeah, this all parts, on certain parts, you make it slightly more accent, we call it. We give it more accent. We give it more strength in the shade, so that it will come loose from the background, that it will get more space-like. So that is Thank what you. You still can do, an excellent way of bringing the toner very softly, but a little bit more variation in grays.
Yeah. Thank you, Martin.
You are welcome, Govindra.
Thank you.
I'll complete it later, Martin. I have a sports practice right now, so I have to go for that.
Yes, I understand.
Thank you so much for the session. It was really helpful. I didn't know how to draw those like symmetrical circles and all that, but now I know the trick, and thank you so much for that.
You're welcome. It was a pleasure to have you in the lesson.
Same here, Martin.
Bye-bye.
Look forward to the next session. Bye.
Okay, that's fine to hear.
Bye, Prerna. Thank you so much for arranging the session.
You're welcome.
Oh, Sushi. Yeah, you're not yet finished, but it's going very fine, especially that I think it's an oil can which you have in front of that is a copper or copper-like thing in your composition. Tell me.
The bottle was a lot more difficult because it had a lot of reflections and stuff, right? So
yes.
I've been kind of struggling with that. But the oil, I think the oil... that oil can was better, and this is my first time using charcoal, so
that's quite good. So you have to get used to it, because the moment you put it on your paper, it's immediately black. So you have to get the right tone out of it, so use it softly. But you do that well, because there is a great variation of grays in your drawing. I think you can still continue if you have time later to make it more subtle. Everything is there, but the dark and the light parts are a bit strong. You can bring in a little bit more the in-between tonal values.
For sure. Another question I had was, usually when I'm painting, right? Mine is more like a, like when I'm painting, right? It's more like top down. I'm looking from the top downwards.
Yes.
So that seems easier for me. When the easel is like upward or facing, right? I think shading is a lot harder for me in that. Do you have any recommendations on that front?
Well, as I look to your drawing, I mean, your jar on top is excellently done with the lid on top. It's very nicely drawn. I don't see really problems in your drawing. Of course, you can improve your symmetrical constructions, but that is something you just have to repeat many times. But if you like to do it more from upside, like a bird's eye view, as we call it, then there's no problem. If you like that better, it's now only that I have to put my laptop in this height against opposite to the still life, so that got the suggestion like that. But if you like more to see from upwards, you're fine. That's okay, no problem. But I don't see any problems really, then, apart from the constructural thing that you can improve that more by being aware of the middle axis and then the both sides, which should be equal.
For sure. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
This class was a pleasure and it was nice to meet you.
It's good to hear. Thank you very much. So, Prerna, we have still Sushi we just had, Govindrai I had, Govindrai and Beatrice.
I know, but I think, so Govind already showed his drawing and Beatrice did. Do you guys want to, I think we're almost at the end of it. If you guys want to share something or ask something, please feel free to do that, or else we'll just close the session in a couple of minutes.
I just wanted to say my name is Sushil.
Oh, sorry.
I didn't know. I know it does look like sushi, but I don't know when was a good time to bring it up.
Sushil, I will do it next time better.
Yeah, Martin, thank you very much. Yes, and I got a very good idea from the way you showed the drawings and the thinking aspect of it, especially the light and the shade. And then the way you shade it, I got a lot of insight on that. So I think I will improve with whatever I've done now. And more or less, it looks good. And then, a little bit of shading here and there, and then the shaping and all those things. I have a lot from you, and really am grateful to you and Prerna too. So thanks for a live session, very, very agile and very informative.
Thank you very much.
Thank
you very much. Yeah,
nice.
Have a nice day.
Yeah, thank you, Govind. Thank you.
Bye. Can we leave?
Yes, please. Yes, we're just ending it. Thanks. I think only Beatrice, are you still here?
Yeah. Sure. Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
I think Beatrice went over. Yeah. I think Beatrice is also, he said thanks on the comment.
Yeah.
So exactly. I think we are good to leave now. Thank you, Martin. It's always a pleasure to work with you.
Yeah.
What can I really say further? Yeah. But yeah, thanks a lot. I think we had a good session.
Yeah.